The life of Christ is the greatest story ever told. We need to know who Jesus is, what he taught, how he lived, and what he promised. In this fifth lesson, we shall continue the study of the life and the ministry of Christ. Period 2. First year of Jesus' ministry, usually referred to as the year of obscurity. Obscure means unclear, not well known. This is the year when Jesus was not known. He was not yet popular. This year of Jesus' ministry is only told in the Gospel of John. The most prominent events that took place during this period are 1. Turning water into wine in Cana. This was Jesus' first miracle. It happened when Jesus had won his first disciples. The event is recorded in the Gospel of John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. The value of this miracle was in what it signified, not in what it brought. It manifested the glory of Christ, part of which glory is his power to change worse into the better, the simple into the richer. It is the glory of Christ that he can transform sinners into his own likeness. It is noteworthy that the miracles of Christ created widespread excitements. John would not have mentioned this event had it not been for the miracle. It had been 580 years since the Jews saw such a miracle. Daniel's survival in the lion's den and his reading of the writing on the Belteshazzar's wall was the last sign of God proving his presence among his people by miracles. 2. First cleansing of the temple. This event is recorded in John chapter 2, verses 13 to 16 only. The occasion was the Passover, and many pilgrims were assembled in Jerusalem. Many of these pilgrims were being exploited by the money changers. What enraged Jesus was that the pilgrims to the Passover who could not afford Shylock charges were being fleeced at an exorbitant rate by the money changers. It was actually corruption being practiced by those influencing traders. It was a rampant and shameless social injustice. And what made it even worse is that it was being done in the name of religion. We can trace at least 3 reasons why Jesus acted as he did. 1. He acted as he did because God's house was being desecrated. In the temple, there was worship without reverence. Worship without reverence is an insult to God. 2. Jesus acted as he did in order to show that the whole paraphernalia of animal sacrifice was completely irrelevant. God does not delight in the vain sacrifices that are offered at the expense of justice, mercy, and faithfulness to him. Neither does he get pleased with our sophisticated and expensive worship rituals that substitute true devotions to him. 3. The buying and selling which went on at the temple took place at the Gentile courts. Nothing has the feelings of God more than human acts that shut out those who are genuinely seeking him in his church. 3. Nicodemus. This story is recorded in John chapter 3. Nicodemus must have been a wealthy man. We read of him bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes of about 100 pounds for the body of Jesus, and only a wealthy man could afford that. He was also a Pharisee. In many ways, the Pharisees were the best people in the whole country. There were never more than 6,000 of them. Nicodemus was a ruler of the Jews. This means that he was a member of the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court of the Jews. The rabbis declared that the best time to study the law was at night, when a man was undisturbed. He therefore may have wanted absolute and undisturbed time with Jesus. There is yet another reason why Nicodemus may have come to Jesus by night. He may have come to Jesus by night as a sign of caution, fearing the reaction of his brotherhood. It is a miracle of grace that Nicodemus overcame his prejudice and his upbringing and his whole view of life enough to come to Jesus. This story has outlined some very basic issues touching on a man's way back home to the Father, such as seeing the kingdom of God, verse 3 and 4, entering the kingdom, verse 5 to 8, and looking for salvation, verses 9 to 15. To be born again, that is the main point of this story, means to be changed in such a way that it can be described as rebirth and recreation. The change comes when we love Jesus and allow him into our hearts. Then we are forgiven of our past and are armed by the Spirit for the future. Then we can truly accept the will of God. And only then can we become citizens of the kingdom and are made sons of God. Then we enter into eternal life, which is the very life of God. 4. Samaritan woman. The story of the Samaritan woman is recorded in John chapter 4, verses 1 to 42. It is a story that openly shows how Jesus was highly involved in meeting people at their points of need. It tells us so much about the character of Jesus. It shows us the reality of his humanity, the warmth of his sympathy, and how Jesus could easily break down barriers of hostility and even cultural customs. It is through this story that Jesus helps us to identify what false worship is. A false worship is a selective worship that chooses what it wishes to know about God and omits the rest. This is a sure indication of a one-sided religion which has perfected the art of snatching fragments of scripture which happens to suit its members and their own positions. A false religion is also an ignorant worship which does not involve the whole man. Religion is never safe until a man can tell not only what he believes, but why he believes it. Peter, in his first epistle, chapter 3, verse 15, says that religion is hope, but it's hope with reason behind it. Jesus said that God is spirit. If God is spirit, it means that God is not confined to things, and therefore idol worship is not only an irrelevancy. It is an insult to the very nature of God. If God is spirit, he is not confined to places, and therefore we cannot limit the worship of him to particular places or spots. This passage closes with a great declaration concerning the Messiah who was now speaking to the woman. The freedom this woman gained after Jesus' touch is a reminder to all humankind that a man may hide his sins, but once he discovers Jesus Christ as Savior, his first instinct is to say to man, "Look at what I was, and now look at what I am. This is what Christ has done to me." He is definitely a changed man. From the story of the Samaritan woman, we find one of the greatest truths of the Christian life. The only real argument for Christianity is a personal Christian experience. There is little use in telling people that Christ will bring them joy and peace and power if our own lives are gloomy, worried, and defeated. Men will be persuaded to try the experiment only when they see that for us it has ended in an experience which is much to be desired. 5. The healing of the nobleman's son. John chapter 4, verses 46 to 54. The conduct of this nobleman has certain things that are an example to all people. One, here is a nobleman who came to a carpenter. He swallowed his pride to walk 20 miles to beg favor from a village carpenter. If we want the help which Christ can give, we must be humble enough to swallow our pride and not care what any man may say. Two, here was a man who refused to be discouraged. He was a man who had faith that if Jesus says a thing, it is not a case of it may be true, but it is a case that it must be true. The man took Jesus at his word, John chapter 4, verse 50. He is not a man who got what he wanted from Jesus and then went away to forget. He and all his household believed. That must always be the story of the Christian life. This event shows that Jesus was establishing himself as one who should be taken seriously. He was establishing his reputation to clear the obscurity. Period 3, second year of Jesus' ministry, the year of popularity. People have heard of Jesus, and now he begins to gain popularity. This period represents the climax of his ministry. This was a year of great temptation for Jesus. Some events during this period include, 1, the choosing of his team, the 12 apostles. This came in the second year of Jesus' ministry. They may not all have been with him, but certainly they knew him. Mark chapter 3 verse 14 tells us that he chose them that they might be with him. That means that he chose them to be his friends. He needed human friendship. It also means that Jesus knew that the end of his time was coming soon, and he chose them that he might write his message upon them. They were to be his living books that might someday take his message to all men. There are two important things to note about this man that Jesus chose to be his apostles and to train for his next 2 years. One, they were very ordinary men. There was not a wealthy, nor a famous, nor an influential man among them. They had no special education. The work of Jesus is not in the hands of men who in the world call great, but in the hands of ordinary people like ourselves. Two, they were a strange mixture. It is one of the miracles of the power of Christ that Matthew, a tax collector, and Simon the Zealot, who was a fanatical nationalist that swore to assassinate any Roman loyalist like Matthew, could live at peace in the close company of the apostolic band. When men are really Christians, the most diverse and divergent types can live at peace together. Two, Sermon on the Mount. This is clearly recorded in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. In Luke's Gospel, the Sermon on the Mount follows immediately after the official choosing of the 12. Jesus' Sermon on the Mount has been observed as the ordination address to the 12. It is in this address that we have the essence of the teaching of Jesus to the inner circle of his chosen men. Scholars have come to believe that they are in fact a collection of sermons that Jesus preached at different occasions. There are certain sections of the Sermon on the Mount which have no connection with what goes before and no connection with what comes after. But in summary, we must understand the main principles of Jesus' ministry to humankind. Jesus came preaching that he might defeat ignorance in us. He came teaching that he might defeat misunderstanding. He came healing that he defeats all the pain we have. We too must proclaim our certainties. We too must be ready to explain our faith. We too must turn these noble Christian virtues and ideals expressed by Jesus in these sermons into action and into deeds that will prove the authenticity of our faith in him. 3. The raising to life of a widow's son in the town of Nain. Jesus happened to be walking to a town called Nain, which was a day's journey from Capernaum. Here he met a procession of mourners headed to the cemetery. No doubt there were shrill cries of grief. He was his mother's only son, and she was a widow. To the compassion of Jesus, he touched the dead boy, and he sat up and started talking. Yes, Jesus claimed as his own what death had seized as his prey. He was moved to the depth of his being. In the nature of things, we live in a world of broken hearts, but thanks be to God. Jesus is not only the Lord of life, he is the Lord of death, who himself triumphed over the grave and who has promised that because he lives, we shall live also. 4. Raising of Jairus' daughter from death. Matthew chapter 9, verse 18 to 26, Mark chapter 5, verse 22, Luke chapter 8, verse 41. Jairus was the president of the synagogue. He was responsible for ordering the public worship. He is the most interesting character in this story. He came to Jesus when everything else had failed him, and there was nowhere else to go. He came to Jesus simply because desperation had driven him there. All the same, he proved that he was a man who could swallow his pride and ask Jesus for help. When all his colleagues were hostile to Jesus, he defied them and associated with him. It is easy to think that we can handle life on our own, but the way to find the miracles of the grace of God is to pocket our pride and humbly confess our needs and ask. Another thing to note is that Jairus was a man of a stubborn faith, but deep in his heart, he had hope against hope. No doubt in his heart, there was a feeling of, you never know what this Jesus can do. And truly, none of us knows all that Jesus can do. In the darkest day, we can still hope in the unsearchable riches and the all-sufficient grace and the unconquerable power of God. There are two other stories in the same section of the Matthew Gospel that draws the same lesson to learn. The healing of the woman with the issue of blood, and the healing of the two blind men that have something in common. The moral of these stories is that we do not have to wait to ask Christ's help on when our motives, our faith, and our theology are perfect. We may come to him exactly as we are. It is not how we come to Christ that matters. It is that we should just come to him, for he is willing to accept us as we are and able to make us what we ought to be. 5. Kingdom Parables, Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13 shows a definite turning point in the ministry of Jesus. The doors of the synagogues were soon shutting down to him. The common people would give him welcome, but the official leaders of the Jewish Orthodoxy were now in open opposition to him. Jesus now takes his message to the temple of the open air and taught men in the village streets and on the roads and by the lakeside and in their own homes. If anyone has a burning message to deliver, he will always find a way of giving it to men. Jesus' teaching had four major themes, namely sin, submission, servanthood, and salvation. He used parables to teach the great truths about the kingdom outlined on these four major themes. These parables are called so because they are about the kingdom of God. They are truth in pictures. Parables are earthly stories with heavenly meaning. It is a realistic story in which we see ourselves in it, but not until we are convicted by it. A parable can therefore be said to be a point of comparison between an accepted truth in the reality of the natural world and a new, similar truth in the reality of the spiritual world. This means that parables are illustrations of life in action. The surest way to interest people is to tell them stories. Surely, there are some things which a man cannot be told. He must discover them for himself. Unless we discover truth for ourselves, it remains a second-hand and external thing. Yes, unless we discover the truth for ourselves, we will almost certainly forget it quickly. Several of Jesus' parables are kingdom parables because they highlight the role of the kingdom in the life of the Christian. The kingdom was central in the life and teaching of Jesus. When John the Baptist came, he preached that the kingdom of God was near. Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. After John gave away his preaching to Jesus, Jesus began by preaching repentance, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. From that time onwards, Jesus centered his life and message around the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. The kingdom he was speaking of includes the church, but definitely larger than the church. The church specifically began on the day of Pentecost, but God's kingdom surely existed prior to that time. It includes everyone of all ages who accepted God into their lives as king, and all those who now accept Jesus, who reigns over the kingdom. Thank you for watching this episode on the study of the life and ministry of Christ. Join me next time as we look at the study of the life and ministry of Christ, period 4.